Hey, if you got a Bible, let's go to 1 Corinthians, please. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, continuing in this short 2 weeks of temptation. I was talking with Abe a couple of days ago about this talk that I was giving tonight, and he said, if you know anything about Abe at all, you know that he loves it when people share their struggles and are genuine and real. And he said to me, man, a lot of people resonated with your story of the hotel room, and so did I. I think you should share another struggle that you have. And I thought that'd be a good idea. And I thought long and hard, and I couldn't come up with anything else. So you laugh because you know that's not true. You know that I face temptation all week. Sunday nights with the cookies is one of them. I was at Hy-Vee this afternoon and was pushing my cart out to the car, and I felt this temptation of, man, that cart corral is really far from my car. I should just be like everybody else and leave this cart right here instead of taking it the 20 feet over there. And I overcame temptation and laziness and took that over to the cart over there at Hy-Vee and did what I was supposed to do. But temptation, those are funny things. Temptation is from big to small areas in our life that each and every one of us face. And just by way of reminder from last week, we talked about temptation and how the enemy and our own desires target our identity. They want us to forget who we are and want us to forget how to relate to God as Father, but instead to relate to our slave master rather than a loving heavenly Father. And we saw that Adam, as our representative of mankind, failed his test in the garden, but looking at the story of Christ and his temptation in the wilderness, he was victorious, making him able to be the substitute and the sacrifice for all mankind who would believe. And so we left off with saying that Jesus Christ memorized or had scripture committed to memory that he quoted from the book of Deuteronomy back to the devil. He said, have you read this, devil? And he quoted, man cannot live by bread alone, and other passages along those lines. And I left you with a small memory verse to think about this week and to hopefully memorize, commit to memory as you face temptation. And if you're in the service this morning, here Pastor Pat allude to it. He didn't think the one that I gave was sufficient, so he gave another one. I gave Philippians 4:19, and he had us memorizing Philippians 4:13, which is also a really good one, too. But I quoted that verse to myself many times this week as I was faced with temptation, that my God will supply my every need of yours according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And I got a text from a man earlier this week that sent me a text saying, man, I tell you what, scripture has the power to break strongholds in your life. And I use this in temptation. And he was just thankful for the power of scripture. Well, our message tonight coincides a lot with Pastor's message from this morning. And that makes sense because this is the same church in the same city, just in 1 Corinthians, which is a little bit earlier. So let's read this together. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 12 and 13. Therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you that is common to man. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability, but with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. This is the word of the Lord. Aren't you thankful for it tonight? So last week, I was listening to National Public Radio, NPR, and I listened to it for two reasons. First one being because I feel really cool when I listen to it. And the second one is that they know how to tell a great story. I mean, seriously, a couple months ago, I was listening to it, and I was enthralled. One of those where you're listening to a story on the radio, and you get home, but you stay in the car to finish it. And it was this guy, this engineer that was on there, and he had been working for years about eliminating the time or taking the time down on what it takes to dry your hands at an air dispenser. And he's like, yeah, 11 seconds, really, people don't want to wait that long. I've really been working hard to get it down to 7. And I'm just so enthralled by this. It was amazing. But just this last week, one story in particular caught my attention. It's a short one. And there was this study done by experts that they found that they could convince someone that they were an expert in a given field, that it would help their self-confidence, they would become more rigid in their thinking, and would become less open to correction. And so they brought people in for this different test, and what they did was some people they gave really easy tests to. Like, this is like really simple, but they made it out to be like, this is one of the hardest tests that someone's ever taken and that nobody does well on this. So that when someone did well, they're like, wow, look at these scores. They're off the charts. You are an expert. Or they would bring others in and would just start to flatter them about given topics. Like, wow, you really know a lot about this topic, don't you? And really built them up. And they found that then when they went into focus groups to discuss this topic, those who they had flattered and given the easy test to would not back down on anything that they talked about. They had become not open to any kind of correction and would not listen to anyone else's ideas because they had been convinced that they were an expert. The great deception of our enemy and of your old self that still remains is that they want you to believe that you're a Christian expert, that you've got it all together, that everything is fine, and you have enough in your own strength to face temptation. And what we have here in Corinth are Christians who thought they were just that, experts. They had some success, they were intelligent, and now they felt like they were strong enough to face temptation in their own strength. In the city of Corinth, we've heard about this, they have this temple of Aphrodite, the goddess of love and sex, right? And there's these converted Christians that came to know God, but we're missing out on the feast that took place in the temple and all the social events that happened there. And so they thought that I could go participate in these social events, these feasts with my friends and not be affected by the idol worship that was going on there. Not be tempted to evil and certainly not to participate in the sexual immorality that was happening along with these feasts. I won't participate in it. It might affect my mind just a little bit, right, as I go home, but I'm strong enough to endure these temptations. And they were priding themselves on how close they could get to evil and not sin. And so Paul writes first to give them a warning. And after he gives them a warning, he gives them some promises that are still true for us today, both this warning and the promise. Well, let's look first at the warning. Let's look again at verse 12. He says, therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed lest he fall. So whenever you're studying the Bible, this is just a helpful little thing. When you get to the word therefore, you got to ask yourself, what's the therefore, right? So you think, what is it that Paul is saying when he says therefore? What is he referring back to? Well, he's giving them a little history lesson of the nation of Israel, referring back to them as a nation who were just like them, confident in their experiences, confident in their surroundings, and confident in their abilities. So let's look back at the beginning of verse 10, and we'll look at verses 1 through 6. For I don't want you to be unaware, he's saying, don't miss this, brothers, that our fathers were under the cloud, that all passed through the sea, all were baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea. All ate the same spiritual food and all drank the same spiritual drink, for they drank from the spiritual rock that followed them, and the rock was Christ. Nevertheless, with most of them, God was not pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things took place as examples for us, that we might not desire evil as they did. It says that they were under the cloud. Paul is making a reference here to the physical representation of the presence of God that led them in the wilderness, the Israelites, by a cloud and by a pillar of fire at night. He says that they saw this. This was a reality all the time in their lives. They passed through the sea, a reference to the Red Sea. They walked through on dry ground. They heard Moses say, "You will never see these Egyptians again." They experienced that. He says that they were baptized into Moses. That means that they were willingly submitting to the leadership of Moses, and he was a phenomenal leader. The scriptures say there was no one more humble than Moses himself. And they were fed with spiritual food. God provided them bread, manna from heaven. They drank from a water from the rock. And Paul gives us a little insight here, although they didn't realize that that rock was Christ, that Christ was the one that was providing for them all along. And so if you can imagine, if you're Israel, you're starting to think, right, man, we're pretty privileged people. I'd say we got it going on, right? They're thinking that of themselves. You know, and all these things that was happening, and it's surprising to read in verse 5 that nevertheless, God, with most of them, was not pleased. And so Paul is showing the church in Corinth, he's saying, let this be a warning to you. Don't let this happen to you. He's saying, do you see the connections here between you and Israel? You've been delivered from your sin. Israel had been delivered from their slavery in Egypt. So have you. You've been baptized, not into Moses, but into Jesus Christ. You're partaking in the spiritual food of communion. You have the most humble leader of all, Jesus. You've had some success, but I don't want you to think, Corinth, that that makes you strong. See, they had thought that they were expert Christians, that they could get close to immorality and that would be okay. It's like the boy that says he's going to go park his car in a parking lot with his girlfriend, and they're just going to talk, right? Never ends there, does it? He said, I can get really close to immorality, flirt with it a little bit, and I'm strong enough, I can handle it. Alistair Begg says, immorality is not something to be flirted with, but to be fled from. So are we confident in our ability? I mean, seriously, think about that for a moment. Do you see yourself? Now, obviously, you would never admit this, but if you were honest with yourself, do you oftentimes see yourself as an expert Christian? Some examples of that might be, or you might be an expert Christian if you're sitting there tonight and thinking, this message isn't for me. I really don't struggle with this. I really hope that person's listening to this. I can hang around with my old high school buddies. They haven't changed at all, but I have, and it's not really going to affect me. I can be around my friend who's constantly talking about her husband and I won't be affected by it. Talking about her husband poorly, that is. That relationship at work, I know with the opposite sex is going beyond just a coworker. We're starting to develop a relationship beyond what it should be. We're starting to flirt, but I got this. It's under control. I'm strong. I don't need to read the Bible daily. After all, I've got really good theology. And church is good. Church is good. But I don't feel like I need accountability. That's for guys who are really weak in their faith. As I did share last week when I was alone in that hotel room and my heart was racing and pounding because I wanted to watch the things that I knew I wasn't supposed to, it wasn't my first time in a hotel room. I knew what was on the TV. But I thought that I was strong enough to handle it. I think a second lesson here that we can learn from Israel is this. Close proximity to godliness does not equal godliness or a lack of temptation. Close proximity to godliness does not equal godliness or a lack of temptation. Have you ever read the stories of Israel? And you're like, man, if I had all that stuff going on in my life, like, I would never be tempted to do anything, right? Maybe you've thought that before, like, you're about ready to be tempted, and then you're like, look out your corner, and you see the cloud sitting right there, and it's like, whoa, okay, yep, not going to do that, right? You're like, man, there's the presence of God right there. I'm not going to be tempted at all. So they were close by, but yet it didn't stop them from worshiping idols. And if you were to read on through verse 11, you'd see that they committed gross and massive sexual immorality. They complained and they tested God, all while seeing the presence of God being under the great leader Moses. They thought their surroundings is what made them godly. They were physically close to God, but weren't close to them in their heart. And I think it's a challenge for us and perhaps a temptation. I know it is in our church here that we see all kinds of wonderful things happening. People being baptized, people coming to know Christ, great preaching of the word, and we can be convinced to think that because I'm close to these things, I'm surrounded by religious activity, I'm doing okay. I'm not susceptible to temptation. But just like Israel, it's really our hearts that matter, not the things that are around us. It's really the conditions of our hearts, not being close to godliness. It's, am I pursuing God on my own and being godly? I'm challenged in the area of this, of working with students and working and having my own children now that are growing up. And I think as parents, we can try to create the perfect opportunities for godliness in our kids, right? And I think we should. But we can have them, they grow up in a Christian home. We send them to youth group, which is definitely a good thing. We can send them to a Christian school, homeschooling, etc. But yet we're often surprised by some of the temptations that they face. Like, wow, I didn't think that you would struggle this. We've set you up to live a very godly life. You've been surrounded by godliness your whole life. So let us not be surprised when our children come to us and students come to us and they talk about these temptations that they have in their lives and things that they're giving into. And so the first lesson for us tonight is to realize that we are not expert Christians. We need to realize that in ourselves we are not strong, that we are undone. And knowing this is a sign of spiritual maturity, of knowing that you don't have it all together. A person who acts like they have it all together is not a spiritual man or woman. I believe that is a very ungodly man or woman because they're not honest about who they really are. And so Paul gives them a warning. He says, don't let this be you. Have a correct idea of who you are. And then along with this warning, he gives them some promises concerning temptation. Let's look at some of those here. Verse 13. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man. God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, he'll provide a way of escape that you may be able to endure it. Here's the first one tonight. Your temptation is not unique. Your temptation is not unique. You can begin to think that you are the only one that struggles with something, or that your temptation is like nobody else's. Nobody else gets me. They don't get it. They don't have the same struggles that I do. And I think we like to think that in our individualistic world that we live in, right? You're special. Everybody gets the participation award, right? You're unique. But the scripture tells us that, no, your temptations are not unique. Others that have gone before you have struggled with the same things and have endured. Others are presently going through the same things as you are. Maybe not exactly the same in every single detail, but they are going through it and enduring. And others will come along in the future who are going through the same things that you are. Now, isn't this, in a sense, this is freeing, isn't it? To know that you're not the only one who's being tempted. I remember when I was in high school, I had an addiction to pornography. And for many years, I thought that I was the only Christian who struggled with it. I said, sure, unsaved people, they struggle with this, right? But I think I'm the only believer that actually struggles with this. And I got together with some guys, and they were sharing and openly talking about their struggles and their what they were going through. And I sat there, and I was like, I'm not the only one. I literally thought I was. And here was this temptation that it was not unique to just me. John MacArthur says this. He says, because all temptations are common, we can confess and share our temptations with one another. Now, that requires you to be humble, doesn't it? To be open and to confess your temptations with one another. It also goes the other way, that if we are going to allow people to share their temptations with us, we need to be what I call and what I've heard from someone else say, a non-blinking friend. Here's what I mean by that. When someone confesses something to you that you're struggling with, if your first reaction is this, oh, right? And you're like blinking so crazy fast. And it's like, oh, you're sweating, right? And I can't believe it. If you're a non-blinking friend, no one is ever going to share with you. You have to understand that your temptation is just like theirs. If you act appalled, everyone is going to close down and share nothing with you. So we as Sailorville, I believe that we've created a culture where it's okay to be open, honest, and real, but yet not stay there, to move on from there. I'll share just a little story. There's a guy in our small group who 2 years ago didn't know the Lord. And the first night we shared in our cell group, let's share our testimonies. And he told this later on, that he was going to share his testimony and let that scare everyone away because he didn't want to be in the cell group anyway. His wife was just making him come. He said, I'm going to scare everyone off. I'm going to tell them everything I've ever done. And he shared that. I mean, he laid it all out there, man. Like, whoa, okay, right? And I'm like, don't blink. You blink naturally. Naturally blink, right? You know what he said? I came back next week because nobody acted like it was a big deal. We acted like it, right? It wasn't my story. But when we understand that every temptation is not unique, it gives us comfort knowing that we aren't going out this alone. Secondly, God does not give you a test that you cannot pass. God does not give you a test that you cannot pass. The root of the word temptation really is the word test. That's another reason why temptation in itself isn't wrong. It's not sinful. It's how you respond to that test that comes before you that makes it sinful or not. When I was a senior in high school, I took some math classes at community college. Not because I was really intelligent, but because this is what you have to take if you want to graduate from high school type of math classes. I couldn't pass algebra. And it was one of these things where you go sit down, right, and there's this teacher in there, and she knows that her job is to get you to pass high school, right? And so we would take these math tests, and it was consumer math, so it was balancing a checkbook and stuff like that, which it's all digital now, so it didn't really prepare me for anything. But anyway, but she would sit there and would do like multiple choice questions with me, and like would do one of those things like, well, we know it can't be A because of this, right? I'd be like, okay. And it's probably not B either. I was like, oh, so it's D? Well, that I can't say. But if we're up to me, I would go with the other option. Okay, C. C it is, right? And here I am, a graduate of high school right here, right? God will never give you a test that you do not have the ability to pass. God is faithful. He is with you in every temptation. Some of you are facing some very hard temptation right in this moment. Your husband has left. You're facing you can't come over, you're wanting to be drunk. And you think, I got to escape and I need to do this. This is how I'm going to find escape in this life. Some of you are paralyzed by anxiety. Some of you are so hurting and you think, this is a test that I cannot pass. And you're being told that by your sin nature from the devil that is around you. And he's saying, no, you can't. You can't pass this test. And he's lying. He's the accuser of the brethren. And when you say, I don't think I can do this anymore, Jesus says, yes, you can. Because I am here. I will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. There is no test that you cannot pass. I am with you. And this is going to hurt. This is going to be a struggle. A wayward son, a wayward daughter. This is testing on me, God. Sometimes I don't even know if I have faith anymore. And God says, I'm with you. You can handle this in my strength. Number three, there is always a way out. You will not be tempted beyond your ability, but with the temptation, he will also provide the way of escape that you may be able to endure it. There is no no-win situation for Christians. There is always a way out from every temptation. Now hear me on this. The way out of temptation, the godly way, will always be the harder choice in the moment. See, our indwelling sin deceives us into thinking in the moment the way out is the easier option. The one that's going to make me feel good. The one that I can just get rid of this temptation altogether. But the way of true escape will be the hardest option in the moment that in the end you'll realize is what you needed all along. And this is from small to big. And someone came up to me and said, hey, did you get my email? And I felt this temptation because I really care about what she thought of me to say, no, I didn't, knowing very well that I had. I thought, Brad, that's going to be easy right here. But you're going to have to tell the truth and say that you read it and you just haven't responded yet. Don't lie. Sometimes the way of escape is to just tell the truth. But we think that if we tell more lies, then it'll feel better and we'll really take care of the situation. That's really not escaping at all. It's coming in and being enslaved even further. But sometimes the way out is you being proactive against temptation. Jesus calls us to this when he says this in Matthew 18, 7 through 9. He says, woe to the world for temptations to sin, for it is necessary that temptations come. But woe to the one who temptation comes, and if your hand or your foot causes you to sin, cut it off and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life crippled or lame than with two hands or two feet than to be thrown in the eternal fire. If your eye causes you to sin, tear it out and throw it away. It is better for you to enter life with one eye than with two eyes to be thrown into the hell of fire. Jesus taking our response and a proactive approach to temptation very seriously. And some of us in knowing, and all of us really in some way or another, knowing that we are not strong enough in ourselves, need to be proactive in preventing sin when temptation comes. In our strong moments, we need to set up barricades through people and other things that will help us in our weak moments. Some of us, we need to get a filter on our internet and on our phone so that it stops us and brings us to our senses before we do anything. I had a filter on my phone that was the world's worst browser. It was awful, and I hated it. But I knew that in the moment, that there was a moment of weakness that would make me come to my senses. Or, bro, what are you doing? Perhaps some of you need to cut off a relationship for a time because you know that it's a sign, it's just a place of temptation. Some of you need to be the best proactive way you can is to be in the Word. That's the best proactive approach to facing temptation. You can't grow apart from God's word. You're not gonna show me a person who is not in God's word, and I'll show you a person that is giving in to temptation. You must be in God's word. We must be proactive. The escape isn't so we'll be completely taken away from temptation, though. It doesn't say that. It says actually you will be given the ability to endure it. The word there means to come under it. To be able to, in the midst of temptation, in God's strength, to endure it and continue through it, to say no and to have victory. See, in yourself, you are not able to face temptation, but as we saw this morning, God has equipped you. He's made you sufficient through Him to help you fight and battle temptation. You have the Holy Spirit, God Himself, living inside of you. You can say no to temptation. But how do we do this long term? Is it just coming along and saying, no, I'm going to say no for the rest of my life? Well, that's not really enjoyable. It's not really fun. And oftentimes, it doesn't work after a period of time. Brad Bigney, our speaker at Men's Retreat, and going to be speaking at the marriage conference here pretty soon, said this. The Bible is not just a bunch of stop signs. But the Bible is one of replacement. So it's not a matter of just saying no to temptation. It's about replacing your temptation with the things of God. Being too busy pursuing God that you don't have time for temptation. Not just fleeing from temptation and running aimlessly to nothing, but fleeing temptation and running to Jesus. Your temptation and mine must be overtaken by something more beautiful, namely Jesus Christ. We have to look at temptation, and the temptation is there. We have to be able to look at Christ and say, this is more beautiful than what I want over here. Thomas Chalmers, the Puritan theologian, calls it this, the expulsive power of a greater affection. So over here is the temptation and what my flesh desires, and over here is Christ, and this eclipses my desire for this over here, for the sin. Let me give you an illustration to help you with this. My daughters have always been crazy about pacifiers. I think we have a photo here. Yeah, that's my middle child. As you can see, that's actually two passies at the same time. I don't know, if she were a smoker, it'd probably be equivalent to one of these, right? But she loved passies. And I remember there was a time where mom was away and she took the other daughters with her, and we were just, Augie and I, sitting at home by ourselves. And as she had a pacifier in her mouth. Now, she loves passies and doesn't ever want to give them up. Well, now she's five, she has now, but then she did not want to give them up ever. Unless there was popcorn. Because she knew that if she was going to have popcorn, she had to take that passy out to eat the popcorn, right? And so here we are. I just popped this big old bowl, and we're watching like Baby Einstein on the couch or something like that, right? And she looks over at me, and she's got her passy in her mouth. And she kind of looks up at me and looks over at the bowl of popcorn and does one of these to me to me and goes like, like, yeah, you're going to have to take that out if you want to eat the popcorn. And so I saw her do, you know, she takes out the passy, holds it in one hand, reaches in, puts the popcorn in, puts the passy back in like this, right? So what happened here? What happened? Did her desire for her passy go away? No, it didn't. She still had an overwhelming desire for that passy, but it was overtaken by a greater desire for popcorn. And this is what we're called to if we are going to face temptation. It's not that our temptation no longer has a grip on us. It's not that we don't desire it anymore. It's that our love and passion for Christ gives us an over-desire above that temptation. You can pass any test that God has brought you through. And the reason you can pass any test is because Jesus has already passed the test for you. He lived a perfect life, never giving in to temptation, qualifying him to be the sacrifice for your temptation. Before God, you are 100% righteous. Before God, if you believed in Jesus Christ, and only if you have believed in him as your substitute, his righteousness is given to you. That means when God sees you, he doesn't see the temptation that you have given into. He sees that you have always obeyed just like Jesus has. And so you don't fight for the letter of the law like we heard this morning to earn God's approval and to get him to be happy with you. You fight temptation because God is completely pleased with you already because of Jesus. It's not a matter of, okay, I'm going to add to the things and I'll be more accepted by God. We fight temptation because we are fully accepted by God simply by believing in Jesus Christ alone. And it's out of joy, out of love for God and what he has accomplished through his son Jesus that we face and we battle temptation. Let's pray. God, I pray that we would not be professional Christians. I pray that we would be honest about who we are, that we are already not yet. Positionally before you, God, we're justified. We're declared righteous. We've been brought into your family. We have an inheritance. But we haven't gotten there yet. We're still in between. In the meantime, may we battle well. May we face temptation, knowing that you faced temptation before us. Where we have failed, you didn't. And we can take hope in knowing that our temptation is not unique. There is not a test that you would give us that we cannot pass. And there is a way of escape by choosing Jesus and being overwhelmed by him. So Lord, I pray for the one that's in this room right now that is on the brink of a huge decision of temptation in their life. May you change their heart. I pray for the one here is just struggling with little things and giving in to little temptations, anger. They're not little to you, God. And I pray that you would help them to rely on you to face and to do battle well. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.